Sacred buildings are designed to inspire, humble, and awe. To provide a space for those of faith to commune with their divine. Before the advent of skyscrapers and megafactories, these were the largest buildings in the world and among the most expensive. Completely dominating the terrestrial landscape or soaring to the heavens above. These sacred structures stand as enduring icons for the communities they were built to influence and to serve. While the popularity of different faiths waxes and wanes, religious buildings abide, providing billions of people with a space for reflection and connection to a higher power. In terms of design, our churches and cathedrals, temples and stupas, synagogues, mosques and shrines couldn't be more diverse, but collectively, they are testament to the universal appeal of the sacred and its role in shaping human civilization from its very beginnings. In Wiltshire, England, stands one of the world's most recognizable icons, Stonehenge. One of Britain's most visited sites, Stonehenge has stood on Salisbury Plain for between 3,500 and 5,000 years. But despite its longevity and familiarity, much about this extraordinary monument remains a mystery. One of Stonehenge's enduring mysteries is how it got here in the first place. Recent experiments suggest that the stones could have been hauled to the site on logs. No mean feat, given where these stones came from. Archaeologists believe that the smaller blue stones, which weigh between 2 and 5 tons, each originated in hills 250 kilometers west of Stonehenge. The larger upright sarsens, weighing in at an average 25 tons, are thought to be from the edge of Marlborough Downs, 25 kilometers to the north of Stonehenge. We may never know exactly how the stones got here, or indeed how they were erected, but given the Herculean effort involved, we can be sure Stonehenge was incredibly important to the people who built it. A number of theories exist about why Stonehenge was built. Some suggest it was an ancient temple aligned with the movements of the sun. Others, that it was a prehistoric computer to predict eclipses, or even a cult center where the sick and injured came to be cured. One of the most popular theories about Stonehenge is that it was a place of worship for druids, high priests and healers of the Celtic culture. True or not, today modern adherents of the Druidic faith gather annually at Stonehenge to mark the winter and summer solstice. To contemporary eyes, Stonehenge might not look like a conventional place of worship, but for modern Druids, Stonehenge is a sacred space, an icon that connects them to eternal and spiritual forces. The story of Stonehenge's origins continues to grow. Recent excavations suggest it might also have served as an ancient crematorium and cemetery, perhaps even a temple for venerating the dead. If so, it's a practice which links Stonehenge to one of humanity's greatest civilizations and to one of its most iconic buildings. The ancient Egyptians were master builders, the first perhaps to understand the use of space, scale and light to create a sense of theatre and awe. Firm believers in the afterlife, they built elaborate tombs and two different kinds of temples. Shrines or mortuary temples for the funerary cults of dead kings and queens, and cult temples dedicated to the gods they worshipped. Stunning examples of both can be found up and down the Nile. But the most impressive collection lies in Luxor, the former capital of Thebes. Rising from the east bank of the Nile, Thebes was once the world's largest city. 3,500 years ago, it boasted a population of about 80,000. Today, it's home to over 1 million and two of the most iconic temples in Egypt. The Temple of Luxor was built over hundreds of years by a succession of famous pharaohs, including the likes of Amenhotep III, Ramesses II, and Tutankhamun, the boy king. Dedicated to the god Amun, his wife Mut, and their son Khonsu, Luxor Temple famously hosted the annual Opet festival, a fertility rite performed to ensure the recreation of the cosmos, the regeneration of Amun-Ra, and the transfer of power from god to pharaoh. The second of Thebes's great temples is a structure equal to Luxor in grandeur and presence, Karnak. In the past, Luxor Temple was linked to Karnak by a 3-kilometer-long avenue flanked by as many as 1,350 sphinxes. Those closer to Luxor bore human-like heads, while those nearer to the first pylon of Karnak combined the body of a lion with the head of a ram, a potent symbol of the god Amun. Built over the course of 2,000 years, Karnak was remarkable in scale and complexity, a veritable city of temples dedicated to Amun and his family. The main precinct alone boasted an assemblage of courtyards and colonnades and as many as 20 temples and chapels. It is still one of the largest religious sites on the planet, covering an area the size of 150 football fields. Like all Egyptian temples, Karnak symbolized the nexus between heaven and earth, the relationship between mere mortals and those they considered divine. The deeper visitors venture into the complex, the more hallowed the spaces become. only the pharaoh and high-ranking priests were allowed into the sanctuary of Amun, accessed via the hypostyle hall. Today, the hall is one of the great architectural wonders of Egypt, a colossal forest of 134 columns tapered to accentuate their height. They represent the primordial swamp where sun god Ra was believed to have risen from the waters of chaos at the beginning of all creation. The walls and columns, and even the roof, are covered in elaborate inscriptions. Painted and etched over many generations, they honor the gods and many pharaohs who ruled the new kingdom of Egypt. The west bank of Luxor is no less impressive than the east. Located here are significant funerary temples, including Medinet Habu, which was built for Ramesses III. Considered the last of the great pharaohs, Ramesses III ruled the Egyptian Empire for 31 years. And the mortuary temple dedicated to his passing is the best preserved in the land. The entrance to Medinet Habu was modeled on the fortresses earlier pharaohs had seen during their campaigns in Syria. And the illustrations that adorn its walls leave little to the imagination. Piles of severed hands and genitals among the victors' gruesome spoils. The riches that were once housed in this funerary complex have long since been looted or removed. But one extraordinary treasure remains, the still vibrant color on many of the columns and walls. Made from minerals mixed with a plant or animal-based glue, they have somewhat miraculously withstood the ravages of time. Beyond the modern-day city of Luxor, thousands of equally remarkable sites vie for attention. Among them, the truly iconic 3,000-year-old temples of Abu Simbel. One of the most visited sites in Egypt after the pyramids of Giza, Abu Simbel is Ramesses II's greatest creation. It was built during his 66-year reign to win the respect of his people and intimidate his enemies from afar. According to some scholars, Ramesses was a bit of a showman. All four statues at the entrance to Abu Simbel depict the master of self-promotion wearing various costumes and crowns, while inside, he's taken the liberty of placing himself in the company of gods. But Ramesses' tribute to his godly status might have disappeared altogether if it wasn't for some clever mortals a few thousand years in the future. Originally carved into a solid rock cliff, in the 1960s, Abu Simbel was completely dismantled, stone by stone, and moved to a new site a few hundred meters away to prevent it being submerged and lost forever under the waters of the Aswan Dam. Thanks to the toil of 3,000 workers over 5 years, an extraordinary icon and one of history's great vanity projects was saved from oblivion. The ancient Egyptians are rightly renowned for building some of the world's most remarkable and enduring icons. But they also made a contribution to other later civilizations by bequeathing a blueprint for building the sacred icon. Sitting on top of the Acropolis in Athens in Greece, the Parthenon is the most iconic religious structure built by the ancient Greeks. The Parthenon's size, grandeur, and stone building materials pay architectural props to its Egyptian forebears. Similarly, in Rome, on the southern side of the Piazza della Rotonda, is the Pantheon. This 2,000-year-old icon is the Roman Empire's crowning architectural glory, and like the Parthenon, owes something to its Egyptian forebears. Completed during the reign of Emperor Hadrian, the Pantheon is one of the best-preserved monuments of ancient Rome. The symmetrical entrance to the temple makes use of granite and marble columns imported from Egypt, which by then the Romans had subdued and controlled. But the real groundbreaking feature of this icon is the massive roof over the rotunda. 43 meters across, 43 meters high, and weighing over 4,500 metric tons, the structure is still the largest unreinforced concrete dome in the world. The dome varies in thickness and composition as it nears the oculus, a feature that lightens the load and brightens the mood of the interior. With the introduction of the dome, the Romans were able to free up space inside their sacred buildings, completely changing the course of architectural history. Although the Pantheon was originally built to honor pagan gods, it was the first of many Roman temples consecrated by the Christians. And historians believe it was this conversion that saved the icon from becoming a ruin. One of the oldest and holiest cities in the world, Jerusalem is today the shared capital of Israel and Palestine. 5,000 years in the making, it sprawls across a rocky plateau in the Judean mountains between the Mediterranean and the Dead Sea. It is home to some of humanity's most sacred icons. Revered for centuries by three great Western traditions, Islam, Judaism and Christianity, Jerusalem continues to attract a vast number of pilgrims. The Temple Mount, or Haram al-Sharif, is revered by Muslims as the site where the Prophet Muhammad ascended to heaven. The Wailing Wall is prized by the Jews. And for Christians, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre marks the site where Jesus was buried and rose again from the dead. For Christians, Jerusalem is the origin of their faith. But soon after the death of Christ, his story spread beyond the walls of this city to give birth to Christianity, one of the world's truly global religions. There are six main branches of Christianity divided between Eastern and Western theologies. But regardless of sect, the essence of belief is consistent. And this revolves around the life, death and resurrection of Jesus, the Son, according to Christians, of the one true God. To celebrate their religion, Christians have erected hundreds, if not thousands, of iconic sacred buildings around the world. places like St. Mark's Basilica, the heart and soul of Venice, Italy. The Cologne Cathedral in Germany, the tallest twin-spired church in the world. And Barcelona's Sagrada Familia, a dazzling monument over 100 years in the making. Spain is also home to the largest Gothic cathedral in the world, the Cathedral of St. Mary in Seville. St. Mary's is, of course, a Christian place of worship, but it has its foundations quite literally in another faith altogether. The cathedral was founded in 1401 on the site of a former mosque and even makes use of its predecessor's minaret to create the Giralda Tower, which now houses the cathedral's 25 bells. Converting sacred spaces from one religion to another has been a common practice throughout history, and the saving grace for many an icon that might otherwise have become redundant. The Mosque of Cordoba was converted to a cathedral after the Spanish city was captured by Christian forces in 1236, but it is still regarded as an iconic monument in the history of Islamic architecture. It was the first to use double-tiered arches to create height in the hypostyle prayer hall, an idea reminiscent of Roman aqueducts. In the original mosque, the columns supporting them were probably recycled from earlier Roman and Visigothic monuments. But over time, as the complex expanded, these have been replaced with 850 columns made from jasper, onyx, marble, granite, and porphyry, a purpley rock with imperial appeal used extensively during the Byzantine and Roman eras. Cordoba's minaret was converted into a bell tower for the cathedral and, as with the Giralda Tower in St. Mary's, topped with the symbol of the cross. Over the centuries, this sacred building has seen its fair share of additions, renovations, and restorations, keeping pace with societal changes and architectural trends. The one constant, however, remains the sanctity of the space it encloses, which, regardless of personal beliefs, reflects the continuum that unites us all. After Christianity, Islam remains the second most popular religion with 1.8 billion followers worldwide. Islam dates from the 7th century and originated in Mecca in modern-day Saudi Arabia, the birthplace of the Prophet Muhammad. Muslims who practice this doctrine believe that Muhammad was Allah's ultimate prophet, sent to reveal their faith to mankind. And a pilgrimage, or Hajj, to the city of his birth is one of the five pillars of Islam. Most devotees make a beeline to Masjid al-Haram, aka the Grand Mosque. Equivalent in area to four football fields, this is not just the most expensive religious structure on earth, it's the most expensive building in history, period. The price tag in today's money, $100 billion. Visitor numbers to the Grand Mosque swell annually during Ramadan, the last month of the Islamic calendar, when more than 1 million Muslims pour into the city. In accordance with tradition, Muslims who perform a Hajj or pilgrimage to this mosque must walk counterclockwise 7 times around the Kaaba. Sitting in the center of the great mosque of Mecca, the Kaaba is the most important building in the Islamic religion, considered by Muslims to be the Bet Allah, or House of God. As Islam spread throughout the world, its architecture followed, and 2 of its most beautiful and iconic mosques are located in Istanbul in Turkey. Historically known as Byzantium and Constantinople, Istanbul is the largest city in Turkey, with a population nearing 15 million. A melting pot of cultures, Istanbul bridges east and west. And at its heart is one of the Muslim world's greatest icons, the Blue Mosque. The Sultan Ahmed, or Blue Mosque as it's popularly known, is the jewel of Istanbul, the last great mosque of the classical period. Built over 400 years ago, the Blue Mosque is today as popular with tourists as it is with the faithful. And like most iconic sacred buildings in the world, its size, majesty, and splendor completely overwhelm. Much of the interior is covered by ceramic tiles, which, together with the blue paint on the ceiling, give the mosque its informal name. Natural light filters through over 200 stained glass windows, bolstered by the incandescent glow of globes in several chandeliers. These were also fitted with ostrich eggs, which were thought to repel spiders, thus avoiding the curse of cobwebs. If one extraordinary icon isn't enough, Istanbul boasts a second, the Hagia Sophia. Sitting just across from the Blue Mosque in the Sultanahmet district, the Hagia Sophia is a mosque with a checkered past. It started life as a Christian church in the 6th century and actually qualified as the largest cathedral in the world for nearly 1,000 years, until St. Mary's in Seville was built. Then in 1453, the Hagia Sophia finally became a mosque. But then in the 1930s, it was secularized and transformed into a museum before reopening again as a mosque in 2020. But true to its eclectic past, the Hagia Sophia welcomes all comers through its fabled doors. With an estimated 1.1 billion followers, Hinduism is the world's 3rd largest religion. And with 33 million divinities to choose from, Hindus appear spoiled for spiritual choice. In reality, though, these deities are simply different ways for followers to approach Brahma, the God who created the universe. However, Brahma is not alone. 2 other gods complete the holy Hindu trinity. Vishnu, the God responsible for preserving and protecting the universe, and Shiva, the destroyer. Hindu temples and shrines are often located at natural sites popular with pilgrims, such as the Batu Caves near Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia. An imposing 42.7-meter statue of Lord Murugan, a beloved deity of the Tamil Hindus, guards the entrance to the caves which honor his incarnation. Made from 1,550 cubic meters of concrete and reinforced with 250 tons of steel, the statue took the better part of 3 years to build and 300 liters of gold paint to finish. To reach the temple cave, the largest and most significant in the complex, pilgrims and sightseers alike must first make a meritorious ascent, dragging themselves up a steep flight of stairs, 272 in all. In India, many iconic temples are located near sacred rivers, for it is believed that water washes away sin. Varanasi is the spiritual capital of India, and at 3,000 to 4,000 years, its oldest city. 23,000 temples line the banks of the Ganges and the labyrinthine streets, with the majority dedicated to Shiva the Destroyer, a god both feared and revered for his ability to transform the world. People come from all over the country to pray, bathe, do their laundry, and attend to the dead, with funeral pyres running 24/7. To be cremated here and to have one's ashes swept into the Ganges is to escape the endless cycle of rebirth. As night falls, devotees gather at Dashashwamedh, the main ghat or steps leading down to the river. Come to witness the Ganga Aarti, a special ritual where prayers are offered to the celestial river of India, bringing the faithful to a sacred communion with their river and their gods. Just 10 kilometers northeast of Varanasi, near the confluence of the Ganges and Varuna rivers, is Sarnath. The birthplace of another great religion, Sarnath is where Gautama Buddha delivered his very first sermon, the turning of the wheel of law. Many historians believe Buddha chose Sarnath because of its proximity to Varanasi, which was already an important center of learning and faith. Today, around 500 million people practice the religion, pursuing the Four Noble Truths and Nirvana, where desire, hatred, ignorance, suffering, and ultimately rebirth have been extinguished through the practice of meditation. There are two main branches of Buddhism, Theravada and Mahayana Buddhism. Theravada Buddhism is the most observed form in Sri Lanka, Myanmar, Thailand, Laos, and Cambodia. 95% of all Cambodians now follow Theravada Buddhism, but in the past, Hinduism was widely practiced. This is Angkor Wat in Cambodia. Built during the first half of the 12th century, Angkor Wat is considered today to be a Buddhist icon. But it's also considered one of the largest Hindu monuments in the world, even though it became a Buddhist temple shortly after its completion. This enormous religious complex, which initially served as the capital of the Khmer Empire, sprawls across a 400-acre site just north of the city of Siem Reap. It is the centerpiece of arguably the most extraordinary archaeological park on the planet, encompassing all of Angkor. The galleries that line its walls are etched with thousands of scenes that depict Cambodia's traditional narrative, the historic and legendary deeds of its heroes and everyday lives of its people, throwing open a window on the past. Although Angkor Wat was originally dedicated to the Hindu god Vishnu, other temples in the vast archaeological precinct have been Buddhist monuments from the get-go, including the otherworldly Ta Prohm, which has almost been swallowed by the jungle, and the exquisite Bayon Temple, located in the exact center of the ancient city of Angkor Thom. Known for its huge stone faces, the Bayon Temple represents the intersection of heaven and earth. Surrounded by over 50 smaller towers, each with four faces of its own, Bayon was built in the late 12th and early 13th centuries and represents the shift in religious thinking that came about during the reign of King Jayavarman VII. He was a forceful and productive ruler who expanded the Khmer Empire both territorially and architecturally, commissioning a massive building program that not only included sacred buildings, but civic works as well. The temples of Angkor are truly remarkable in scale, but none can compete with one particular and extraordinary Buddhist icon. The largest Buddhist temple in the world is on the island of Java in Indonesia. It is called Borobudur. Built on a hilltop in the 7th century, Borobudur is a temple that's meant to be climbed. According to the tenets of Mahayana Buddhism, pilgrims must test their faith physically as well as spiritually. And Borobudur achieves this in spades. To reach the top, pilgrims pass 72 latticed stupas and 504 statues of Buddha, positioned in the shape of a lotus around the terraced hill. Together with nearly 3,000 bas-reliefs on the monument's lower terraces, they constitute the greatest single collection of Buddhist sculpture in the world. Illustrating the life and teachings of Buddha, the reliefs are arranged like pages in a book, guiding the faithful as they climb from one symbolic plane of consciousness to the next. The third great wonder of sacred architecture in Southeast Asia is here at Bagan in Myanmar. Bagan is an ancient city of temples, monasteries, and pagodas, languishing on a bend of the Irrawaddy River, which cuts its steady-as-she-goes swathe through the central plain of Myanmar. A thousand years ago, Bagan was incredibly prosperous, the political and spiritual center of an empire that was fast becoming one of the most powerful in Southeast Asia. By the 13th century, it was home to 200,000 people and at least 10,000 sacred structures. A litany of floods and earthquakes, incursions and invasions have robbed the former royal capital of its glory, reducing the town in size and stature. Today, only 2,229 monuments remain, many in a state of ruin, but they still create a panoramic view that is, in every sense, iconic. The vast majority of Bagan's residents practice Theravada Buddhism, beginning most days with the ritual of giving alms to the local monks to show respect. It would take months, if not years, to complete a pilgrimage to each and every monument that remains in this sacred landscape. So devotees tend to visit those with the greatest significance. The largest of Bagan's temples is Dharma Yangyi. Orientated to the east, it extends some 255 feet on all four sides. It was built during the reign of King Narathu, who, by all accounts, was a psychopath. To secure his throne, Narathu killed his father and older brother and executed his stepmother for irreligious behavior. Many believe Narathu built Dharma Yangyi to atone for his sins. But true to form, it's also rumored that Narathu executed Dharma Yangyi's architects so they could not repeat their design. No doubt to the great relief of his subjects, Narathu's reign was short-lived. He was assassinated in 1171 before his temple was complete. One of the oldest surviving temples in Bagan is Ananda, a symmetrical masterpiece constructed over 930 years ago during the reign of King Kianzita. Reflecting the endless wisdom of the Buddha, the Ananda has six terraces and a central spire that soars 51 meters into the sky. Statues of the Buddha at various ages are stationed at each entrance. While scenes from his life are recorded in terracotta throughout the entire complex. Although the walls are now whitewashed, there is evidence they were once adorned with murals, medieval frescoes the locals are hoping to restore. To visit Myanmar's most sacred temple, pilgrims and travelers must leave Bagan and head due south to the bustling city of Yangon. This is the incomparable Shwedagon Pagoda, which rises like a beacon of hope and calm amidst the clamor of contemporary life. Spiritually and materially, Shwedagon is quite literally worth its weight in gold. For Buddhists, the color symbolizes happiness, purity, enlightenment, and freedom. But to everyone else, incredible wealth. At least 20,000 bars of gold were used to plate the main stupa, a glistening wonder some 112 meters high. That in itself is worth a small fortune, and yet it pales against the estimated value of the stupa's crown or umbrella. It's difficult to see from a distance, but it's richly adorned with 4,000 golden bells, 5,500 diamonds, and 2,300 rubies. The most precious gemstone in this so-called crown of Burma sits at the very top, a 72-carat diamond weighing 15 grams. The whole extravagance from top to bottom is worth over $4 billion, 5% of Myanmar's annual GDP. It's a steep price tag by any measure, but the simple treasures buried within the stupa are the real draw card for devotees. Four sacred relics that include eight priceless strands of Gautama Buddha's hair, relics more priceless than the temple itself. When it comes to naming and faming the most iconic sacred building in the world, few would argue with this nomination, St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. To millions of Roman Catholics, St. Peter's Basilica is their holiest site. The giant basilica sits in the heart of Vatican City, which at just under half a square kilometer is the world's smallest state. Popes have been living in the enclave since 1377, and while St. Peter's is not the official seat of the papal office, given its proximity to the residents, it still hosts many of the key ceremonies associated with the Roman Catholic Church. The plaza that leads to the entrance of the basilica is an architectural marvel in its own right, with its Egyptian obelisk and massive Doric colonnades which metaphorically embrace those who visit the Vatican in the maternal arms of Mother Church. The basilica was built on the site where Peter the Apostle was crucified and buried, and consequently bears his name. Consecrated in 1626 after a 120-year period of construction, the scale of this building is stupendous. The grand facade alone is larger than a football field, complete with statues offering 13 of Christianity's greatest team players, carved in travertine marble. The central balcony, or Loggia of the Blessings, is where all new popes are first presented to the world, after their secret, ritualized election by the College of Cardinals. Once a pope is chosen, a cardinal announces to the public in Latin, Habemus Papam, we have a pope. The portico, which in its own right is larger than many churches, leads visitors into the interior, which is truly immense, big enough to accommodate 20,000 people at a time. Masterpieces by many great Renaissance artists count among its treasures. But even Bernini's 10-story high solid bronze canopy that sits over the main papal altar is dwarfed by Michelangelo's dome, floating some 448 feet above it, one of the tallest in the world. The entire structure appears to be painted, but it's actually covered in mosaics made from millions of tiny glass tiles. The other remarkable icon that sits within the realm of the Vatican, adding immeasurably to St. Peter's status, is the incomparable Sistine Chapel, where, once again, all eyes are compelled to look up to behold more of Michelangelo's genius, a series of illustrious frescoes that bring the Bible's Old Testament teachings to life. The massive painting over the altar illustrates the second coming of Christ and the Last Judgment, with those souls who were saved ascending to the left and the damned descending to the right. Impressive in scale, overwhelmingly beautiful, St. Peter's Basilica is an extraordinary icon. It is at once an expression of the divine, an embodiment of the Holy Spirit, and a lasting testament to human ingenuity. Perhaps the most remarkable thing about our planet's sacred icons is that they endure. The way they were built, the reverence they inspire, speaks volumes about the nature and nurture of humankind. Regardless of our religious affiliations, we recognize in these structures a universal appeal. A sense of community that draws us together to share a quest as old as time.